Good morning. Thanks for starting your Monday here on Spectrum News 1. I'm Charles Dickens.
And I'm Stef Manisero. I hope you all had a wonderful weekend. You as well, Charles. Good morning. It is another somber day here in Houston as the world prepares to say its final goodbye to George Floyd. Check out the memorial that's growing here right in front of the church. Yeah, good morning. Tonight we will see the three top-tier candidates take center stage. Former Vice President Joe Biden has held on to the lead throughout this primary, but Senators Warren and Bernie Sanders are in a tight race for that number two spot right now. Earlier in the week, we saw Warren pass Sanders. Now, as for the seven other candidates, tonight's really one of their final chances to make a name for themselves, to prove that they are still in this race.
We're in one of those very high wind, heavy rainfall periods right now. And like you said, we were journeying to Houston. We wanted to be able to be there to bring you the latest that was happening there. Obviously, one of the areas getting hit the hardest. We heard the National Weather Service say that they are now predicting possibly up to 50 inches there in total, something that they have never seen before. So we got as far as Waller, like you said, 40 miles outside of downtown Houston, and once we got here, it became very clear that we were not going to make it much farther than this. Every way we tried to go was, you know, just major highways, extreme flooding, so we decided to play it safe.
Telling a personal anecdote, Sharpton said, "We've come a long way, but you have to understand how far we have to go." And people here in Houston share that same feeling. They feel this beginning. They feel that as a nation, we are on the cusp of change, but they also know these conversations, this movement, cannot end here today.
This is an incredible amount of water. We were having some difficulties earlier, you know, hard to tell exactly where the road is, where the grass is. Have you ever seen anything like this in this area?
Not out here.
You could see it out here. It's still pouring, still windy. The conditions are not letting up, and we don't expect them to for a while. But in the meantime, we are going to try to save as many people who are stuck in their homes right now or stuck wherever they may be, and hopefully bring them to safety. There's a reason they call him the mayor here in Waco. He's got a big personality to match that 7'1" physique of his. He had me cracking up the entire time I was with him yesterday. Are they excited? They have been waiting for kickoff for, what, 2 years now? I know it's very foggy. We've been mentioning that throughout the morning, so I hope you can see the progress here at the stadium. But we heard it's 75% complete, and if you saw yesterday's turnout after this jersey was launched and released, I think it's safe to say that people are excited. There we go. There we go. If you haven't seen it yet, this is a look at it. You know, what Arthur Blank loves about this program in particular is that it doesn't so much focus on how to help people get rid of their stutters per se, but instead on not letting their stutter silence them. The goal for today's drive was to get 75 donations. They beat it. They got 83. And you know, typically donations are lower during these summer months. But on top of those normal patterns, as people started getting out of the house more businesses and medical facilities opened up, and that really upped the number of elective surgeries, trauma cases, and organ transplants. I do want to talk more about that $20 million that I mentioned there. It's a legacy grant from the Arthur M. Blank Family Foundation that'll go to a research lab at UT Austin to learn more and better understand the nature of stuttering and effective treatment for people who do stutter. Mr. Blank says this is something near and dear to his heart. He comes from a stuttering background. He himself used to stutter, and he says he still does on occasion, especially when he gets super anxious or angry. After 5 days of counting votes and watching numbers from four states trickle in, the Associated Press has projected Joe Biden to be our 46th president of the United States. The call was made after enough votes came in from Pennsylvania this morning to determine the state's 20 electoral college votes would in fact go to Biden.
Trickled in.
Which state would tip first? Yeah. And it's, I guess, Democrats, safe to say, they weren't really surprised this morning because of the trends that we had seen, especially with the mail-in vote and the way those were turning. Really interesting, though, because those the ballots that were cast first and the ones counted last. Karina, we, as always, appreciate your insight breaking it down for us. What do you make of both Biden and Harris's speeches tonight? We heard a lot about moving forward. Mm-hmm. And I think now the question becomes, how do we do that? It feels like for so much of the last few months, of the past year, of the past 4 years, we've been looking toward Election Day and talking about this election. And now, as a nation, it's going to be our responsibility, our duty to kind of move forward. And the question again becomes, How do we do that?
You know, it's really interesting. It's the one demographic that Trump has gained since 2016. And I was reading a New York Times article about this, explaining that more so than any demographic, Latinos are a very diverse demographic within themselves. What do you make of it here in Texas, and how does that play into what we see on Tuesday?
Brisket, pulled pork, sausage.
Brisket, come on. We'll be right back.
I agree with him for once.
You know, we have so much thanks we owe to technology and so many aspects of our lives throughout this pandemic. Of course, we keep talking about El Paso as the hotspot, and things just sound so dire there compared to the rest of the state. Tell us, what's the mood? What's it like actually being there?
And then Saturday is the really big day. Austin FC hosting the San Jose Quakes. That is going to be their first match at the new Q2 Stadium. I know so many people just incredibly excited about this team, this MLS team coming to Austin, our third MLS team here in Texas, and just further proof of how quickly the sport of soccer is growing. So many fans have been at those city council meetings right from the very beginning when the team was just talking about moving here from Columbus, and it really is a sport that is so centered around the fans, and it's supporter based, and that's such a big part of the culture, and it's just only fitting that they're such a big part of getting the team here. So it's going to be a big payoff this weekend to finally see the team take the field. The field is beautiful, right, guys? The stadium is gorgeous. If you haven't been out there,
the grass is lovely.
It's a masterpiece. Yes, we followed the grass from the very beginning.
Yes.
And it's hard to believe that after all these years, 5 years almost, it's all going to happen.
You gotta love Darby, gotta love Patty, gotta love that accent. Tell me how you
I love that accent too.
It's so good.
Well, hell, my mama could cook a pork butt. That is the best, right?
I talked to a pit master one time who said, in Arkansas, they spell barbecue P-O-R-K, and in Texas,
right,
they spell it B-E-E-F, and he's kind of like toying
that
debate.
That's exactly what he was saying. That's so interesting that you bring it up.
Pickleball, you are the on-staff pickleball expert, so take it away.
I don't know how I got that reputation, but I'm here
We haven't played.
You're on TV with a thing in your hand.
You got a leg up on both of us. But yeah, if you don't know about pickleball, basically it's a combination of tennis, ping pong, and badminton. That's what they say. And pickles. But yeah, it's a super good sport for any generation. I know it kind of gets this reputation as an older person's sport because it is really good for people who are rehabbing from injuries or recovering from surgeries, things like that. These girls behind me, the pickleball grannies is what they call themselves, and they are totally hooked.
And they couldn't believe that we've never played pickleball.
I can't believe you've never played. Did you play that day?
No, because the wait was too long, I gave
young,
up.
Young people
I'm
don't like to wait online either.
That's the misconception, is this sport for older people? And again, you just heard, you know, the guy who was battling Parkinson's, and it's helping him just stay athletic. And I've heard so many people just like that. So it does kind of have this reputation as a sport for older people, but it's not true. A lot of young people, like you said, are playing. I actually spoke with a young gentleman, 16 years old, who dropped out of school, became homeschooled so that he can travel to play competitive pickleball. He wants to go pro one day.
Did you talk to his parents?
his mom actually said pulling him out was such a tough decision for her, you know, because she's kind of the one who's like left to homeschool him. But they said it's a great decision.
Who has seen it all?
Oh, yeah. He has been, you know, to war and back. He has covered an enormous amount of stories, impactful, powerful stories throughout his journalism career. And in the baseball world, he just has seen so many. 21 seasons, right, covering one sport, you learn a lot.
One sport, one team, too, right?
One sport, one team. He also has now written a book with Red Murph, who actually was the scout who discovered Nolan Ryan.
How do you get up every morning and do the same thing for 20 years?
He just loves it. Like, he is just one of those guys who, if you couldn't tell from that story, just loves baseball. He loves what he gets to do every day. He wakes up, he starts prepping right away for the game, and he says his favorite part is just kind of getting to know these players. You forget that that's what announcing is. It's storytelling, and you can add so much to a broadcast by knowing the stories behind those players.
Where does the pickle part of pickleball come from, right?
The name?
Yeah, the name Pickleball. Okay. It's a weird name, right?
I'm going to talk myself through this. I believe, as legend has it, there was a couple of dads on a ferry with their young children up in the Seattle area, the Pacific Northwest, years ago. And again, legend has it that they were just kind of trying to entertain some bored kids on this boat ride, on this ferry over. So they kind of came up with a game, made up some rules on the spot, and their dog's name was Pickles.
Oh.
So they ended up calling it Pickleball, and it kind of just took off from there. It's really fun. If you haven't tried it, it's super addicting. People love it. There's a reason those lines are long. Get out there and try some pickleball.
Yeah. Invite us. Maybe.
We'll be right back.
We're not Jeb.
Boom.